Allah wants ease and ease for you. And Allah does not want to make difficulty upon you. And the verse, the last verse of Surah Al-Baqarah was a dua that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he recited it, one of the yani verse, one of the ayat in that verse was Rabbana wa la tahmil alayna isran kama hamaltahu ala alladhina min qablina. Oh my Lord, oh our Lord, do not make us carry a burden like you did make those before us carry. So the people of Musa alayhi salam, they were made to carry a lot of burdens, things that are today halal for us was haram for them. They were not able to pray inside their homes. Allah, the Prophet ﷺ, for example, says, "Ju'ilat liyal ardu masjidan wa tahura." The whole earth has become a masjid for us. Meaning, wherever fa'inama adrakatka as-salah, falyusalliha. Wherever a prayer has become, or wherever the timing of the prayer has entered, then you can pray it wherever you are, whether you're in the market, or on a field, or in a masjid, or at your homes. Whereas the people before us, they were commanded to pray in the masajid. When a salah becomes obligatory, they had to pray in the masjid. So it was a burden upon them. Whereas Allah made it easy for us. Likewise, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or Allah, when he sent Isa, one of the reasons Isa came was وَلِأُحِلَّ لَكُمْ بَعْضَ الَّذِي حُرِّمَ عَلَيْكُمْ, to make permissible some of that which was made impermissible for you, O Bani Israel. So, وَعَلَى الَّذِينَ هَادُوا حَرَّمْنَا كُلَّ ذِي ظُفُرْ وَمِنَ الْبَقَرِ وَالْغَنَمِ حَرَّمْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ شُحُومَهُمَا إِلَّا مَا حَمَلَتْ ظُهُورُهُمَا أَوْ الْحَوَايَا أَوْ مَخْتَلَطَ بِعَظْمٍ. So there are, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for example, mentions in these verses upon the Jews, the people of Bani Israel, that Musa alayhi salam came to, many things that are today halal was haram for them. And so Isa, when he comes, Isa says, لِأُحِلَّ لَكُمْ بَعْضَ الَّذِي حُرِّمَ عَلَيْكُمْ, to make permissible and halal some of that which was made haram for you. Yes, the consumption of pork and alcohol was haram for the nations before us, and it stays and remains haram. Like, for example, the fat that we gain or get from the cow and the milk, all of that is halal for us, unconditionally. Whereas it used to be haram for the people of the, or the Jews. So Allah in this verse, he tells us, I've prescribed fasting upon you like I did upon the nations before us. So don't think that it is to make things burdensome for you. And then Allah says, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ, perhaps you may gain consciousness from Allah, or God consciousness, or taqwa. In order for you to gain taqwa, have I prescribed fasting for you. And taqwa means that you are conscious of Allah in your dealings, in your actions. When you deal, you understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is looking on. And so you do not speak except with that which Allah is pleased with. And you don't act upon that which Allah is not happy with. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in a hadith, he would say, for example, O youngsters, whoever is able to get married, then get married. من استطاع منكم الباء فليتزوج. Meaning, if you're able to financially and physically to get married, the Prophet ﷺ would encourage the youngsters to get married. Financially, if you're able to do so, you're able to carry that responsibility of another person, then get married. And whoever is not able to get married, the Prophet ﷺ says, then let them fast. فَإِنَّهُ لَهُ وِجَاءُ, for it is a protection for you. Another Prophet ﷺ says, أَغَضُّ لِلْبَصَرِ وَأَحْصَنُ لِلْفَرْجِ, it is far more easier for you to lower your gaze when one is fasting. Meaning the fasting, it wasn't, the objective of fasting wasn't for you to lose weight or for you to get used to not eating. No, that wasn't the objective of fasting. In fact, there's a hadith that made it very clear, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Man lam yada' qawla zuri," whoever does not abstain from evil speech, "wal 'amala bih," and acting upon evil speech and ignorance, "falaysa lillahi hajatun fi an yada'a ta'amahu wa sharabahu," Allah is in no need for such a person, one that has not abstained from talking evil, Allah is in no need for them to abstain from their food and drink. For them to abstain from eating and drinking, Allah is in no need of that. Meaning that was not the objective. You've forgotten the objective. The objective was to gain taqwa, to become closer to Allah and to gain God consciousness. Which means that when the month of Ramadan has completed, there should be a change within you. Your actions, the way you act, the way you behave before the month of Ramadan and at the end of the month of Ramadan or after the month of Ramadan. If you don't feel a change in terms of you ensuring that you pray your prayers on time, in terms of you being more aware of consuming halal and abstaining from haram, you're more worried now. You used to be involved in haram before Ramadan. After Ramadan, you are worried. Can I continue my lifestyle the way I did? If you have that feeling, that worry, then inshallah your fasting is accepted. And the objective was reached, which was to gain taqwa. Lakin if you don't have that, and you don't have that worry, and you continue to deal in haram and to consume haram, and you, that worry does not even descend upon you, that is a big sign that your fasting perhaps may not have been accepted. Why? Because it hasn't had an impact on you. And fasting is supposed to have an impact on you. So if it didn't have an impact on you, then it means that your fasting probably was not accepted. May Allah accept all our fasts. And you can think of it as a car wash. Fasting is a car wash. And when you take your car to a car wash, and you, so before you take it to the car wash, the car is dirty. After you take it, the car becomes clean and mashallah, the dirt is removed. Fasting cleanses you, and it should remove your dirt. However, if your car is still dirty at the end of Ramadan, or at the end of the car wash, it means that there's a problem with your car in this scenario. There's no problem with the car wash, because there's no problem with Ramadan. The things stay the same. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He prepared the environment for us, locked the devils, made, opened the jannat, and locked the hellfires, right? And this is the impact of it is that we see ourselves becoming far more religious in the month of Ramadan. So our children would want to fast, our children want to come to the night prayers. So the environment was prepared for you. Ramadan is prepared. Like, are you able to, and are you willing to accept that environment? And if you are, then there has to be a change after Ramadan. And if not, then there's a problem and you weren't able to accept it. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the famous hadith where he said ameen to a dua that Jibreel made, the dua was, Allahumma man adraka ramadana wa lam yughfar lah, wa Allahumma raghima anfu mri'in adraka ramadana wa lam yughfar lah. May one's nose be rubbed into dust. May he reach no good. One that has reached the month of Ramadan and he has not been forgiven. So inshallah, the month of Ramadan is to have an impact on us at the end of Ramadan. Our lifestyle needs to change. If you feel that, then Ramadan, inshallah, or your fasting is accepted. That is one of the benchmarks that you can use. Is my Ramadan accepted or not? How do I feel after Ramadan? Am I closer to Allah? Do I fear Allah more? Am I more aware of what I do, my actions, my prayers? Do I ensure that they are prayed on time? And what I consume, is it of halal nature? All of that, if we have that feeling and if we have that sense, then inshallah Ramadan is accepted. So one of the things that we also have to be aware of is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He sent down this religion. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose this religion. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he encouraged the Muslims to learn their religion. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he encouraged it. In a hadith, he would say, "Man salaka tariqan yaltamisu bihi ilman, sahala Allahu lahu bihi tariqan ila al-jannah." One that seeks a path, one that goes out to study this religion, to learn the Quran, to learn the statements of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, sahala Allahu lahu bihi tariqan ila al-jannah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes the path of Jannah easy for them. So the path of Jannah is made easy for them. And the opposite holds true as well. One that does not go and seek to learn this religion, whether it is on a weekly basis or on a daily basis or every fortnightly, yani one that does not seek to learn this religion, Allah will not make the path of Jannah easy for them. Whereas one that learns the religion and wants to go forth, learns it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes the path of Jannah easy for them. So this is how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would encourage people to learn their religion. Whether it is a weekly dars that you attend in the masjid, or a lesson that you do on a weekly basis that you listen to and you learn, this is something that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is encouraging, yani that you learn about your religion. Likewise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, never did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala command the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to increase himself with anything except with knowledge. Never did the Prophet was the Prophet commanded to say, "Oh Allah, increase me in honor," or "Oh Allah, increase me in status," or increase my wealth. Lakin Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded him and said, "وَقُلْ رَبِّ زِدْنِي عِلْمًا." And "Oh my Lord," and say, the Prophet is being commanded, say, "Oh my Lord, increase me in knowledge." So the Prophet was commanded that. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also in the Quran says, يَرْفَعِ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمَ دَرَجَاتِ. Allah raises the believers from amongst you and those that have knowledge, darajat, ranks upon ranks. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raises them. And they are raised يعني, on the Day of Judgment. Likewise, Allah asks a rhetorical question and He says, هَلْ يَسْتَوِي الَّذِينَ يَعْلَمُونَ وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ إِنَّمَا يَتَذَكَّرُ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. Are those that know and those that don't, are they the same? No, they're not. And only those that understand and have understanding, understand that they're not the same. Those that have knowledge of this religion and those that don't, they're not the same. So it's encouraged that we يعني, learn our religion, whether it is on a weekly basis or on a monthly basis, that we attend a dars. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he passed away, Aisha radiallahu anha, she would say, he has not left behind any wealth except 7 dinanir, 7 dinars, which is yani almost nothing. He's not left behind any wealth. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he himself, he would say, we, ma'ashir al-anbiya'i, la nurath, us prophets, we don't get inherited. Meaning the wealth that we leave behind, even if it was a large amount that he's left behind, it does not get inherited. It doesn't get passed on to his children, his daughters. The Prophet ﷺ says, we do not get inherited. مَا تَرَكْنَاهُ صَدَقَةً. What we leave behind becomes صَدَقَةً. It becomes charity. It goes to the poor and the needy, and it is distributed to them. It becomes صَدَقَةً. Like what we have left behind, the Prophet ﷺ says, is knowledge. What we've left behind is knowledge. And what we can inherit from the Prophets is knowledge. وَرَثَةُ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ. The Prophet ﷺ would refer to those that have يعني, learned the religion as those that have taken a portion of the inheritance of the Prophets. وَرَثَةُ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ. وَإِنَّمَا وَرَّثُ الْعِلْمِ. The Prophet ﷺ would say, we have left behind knowledge that you can inherit. فَمَنْ أَخَذَهُ أَخَذَهُ بِحَظٍ وَافِرٍ. So whoever takes it has taken it with يعني, great portion. He has taken something great, something honorable. And Abu Hurairah رضي الله عنه, after the death of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he would go to the markets and he would say to the Muslims, go to the masjid of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, go there for the inheritance of the Prophet ﷺ is being divided up. People are taking a share from the inheritance of the Prophet ﷺ. Go and take some of it. So people would go to the masjid and they would find no wealth being distributed. They're expecting inheritance. Normally is wealth that you يعني, inherit. So they found no wealth being distributed. Like what they found in the masjid was halaqat, one after the other, groups of companions learning, one here studying the Quran, others there revising a certain matter in the region, يعني groups of groups in the masjid. So they came back to Abu Huraira and they say, what you've informed us, we didn't find it. We went to the masjid, we didn't see wealth being distributed. Where is the inheritance of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? Where is it being distributed? So Abu Huraira would say, what did you see? And they would say, we found hilaq, groups of people studying. And Abu Huraira would say, that is what the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam left behind. Go and take a portion of it, for that is the inheritance that he's left behind. So, yani studying and learning the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a path that continues forever until your death. And so, and it is important that we have that boost, either on a weekly basis, that we stay away from our works and our studies and our workplaces, and we turn to studying the Quran or studying a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or we join a group of people that are studying, whether in the masjid. Also, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he would say that the angels would flap their wings around those that are in a masjid like this. We, yani, at the moment, we believe that angels are flapping their wings around us. Why? Because we're studying and we are learning about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the religion and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would say that the angels would flap their wings, protect them, and tatanazzalu alayhim ar-rahmah, ridan bima yasna. Pleased, angels are pleased with what such people are doing, studying about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they would flap their wings. وَإِنَّ الْمَلَائِكَةَ لَتَضَعُ أَجْنِحَتَهَا لِطَالِبِ الْعِلْمِ رِضًا بِمَا يَصْنَعُ. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would say that the creation of Allah would seek forgiveness for one that seeks knowledge. One that goes and studies, seeks knowledge, the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would forgive, ask for forgiveness for them. حَتَّى الْحِيْتَانِ فِي الْبَحْرِ. Even the fish in the ocean would say, oh Allah, forgive so and so for his studying the Quran. Oh Allah, forgive so and so for his studying the Quran. And yani even the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would seek for forgiveness for such people. So we should make it a habit, especially after Ramadan, after COVID, inshallah, when the masajid are fully open and the durus are running, that we join lessons, whether it's 2 hours a week or an hour a week, or whatever we're able to do, yani that we join those lessons. Not only would you increase yourselves in knowledge, like you would also increase yourself in forgiveness and the rahmah that descends upon you. That is only, yani the forgiveness and the rahmah that you receive is the is one part of what you get. The other part that you seek is that you're learning about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that you're learning about your religion and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So inshallah, the plan was to start, and hopefully maybe we'll continue after Ramadan, to start principles of tafsir. So the Quran, we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the Quran upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when we say inna anzalnahu fi laylatil qadr, we've sent the Quran in a night of power. Or when Allah says inna anzalnahu fi laylatil mubarakah, we've sent the Quran on a blessed night. Laylatil qadr, the Quran came down. Does that mean that the Quran, all of it came down on Laylatul Qadr? What about the fact that the Quran would come down to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam throughout the 23 years? We know that the first verses that came were اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق. Throughout his life, the Quran would come down according to events that took place. Every event that took place, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to guide people to how, as to how to maneuver in such an event, he would send certain verses down. So how do we bring this together, yani, that the Quran came down in Laylatul Qadr and that the Quran came down in the space of 23 years? First of all, we know that the first verses that came down, اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in this cave, غار حراء, or he was in the cave, the Quran, that was in the month of Ramadan when that verse came down. When Allah says إِنَّا أَنزَلْنَاهُ فِي لَيْلَةِ الْقَدْرِ, means that we've descended it from the lowest, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to the lowest heavens in Lawh al-Mahfuz. It came down to Lawh al-Mahfuz on Laylatul Qadr. From Lawh al-Mahfuz Jibreel, it will be revealed to Jibreel alayhi salam according to the events that took place. So this is يعني, the qadr. It came down on Lawh al-Mahfuz. And we know that the qadr, the predestiny of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, has stages. So we know that everything is predestined. We know that our spaces in Jannah, inshaAllah, are already prepared. We know that the spaces of hellfire and whoever goes to hellfire, they've already been prepared. And our places in Jannah have also been prepared. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the qadr and calamities that befall us, all of that has already been prepared. So, and that is in Lawh al-Mahfuz. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created that قبل أن يخلق السماوات والأرض بخمسين ألف سنة أو كما قال 50,000 years before anything was created, everything was already created and Allah knew everything. Now, there may be a confusion, as the companions would ask the Prophet ﷺ, they would ask themselves as well, فَبِمَا نَعْمَلْ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ Why are we then behaving? Why are we acting? Why are we praying? Why are we believing? If our places have already been destined, why do we act? And the best example that can be given is the example of a teacher. Imagine a teacher teaching a student throughout the year. From September all the way to June, he's teaching him maths. And he teaches him maybe 7-8 hours a week. And every week he asks them questions. What is this? And how do you solve this? At the end of May, this teacher comes to you as a parent and he says, I'm fearful that your son is going to not pass the exam. And he won't pass the exam, so I'm worried. So it may be best to maybe retake the year, but I don't think he will pass the exam. And this is maybe a week before the exam. And then the exam comes, the student goes into the exam, and lo and behold, he fails. Was this teacher, did he have knowledge of the unseen? How did he know that he's going to fail? Who told him? Did Allah reveal it to him? What happened? Throughout the year, he understood what type of student this man is, right? He understood that this child doesn't do their homework. Whenever they come in class, asked questions, aren't able to solve the questions. So throughout the year, he understands who this individual is, Ahmed or Hussein. Whosoever, he knows that this student, he doesn't work hard, he doesn't try, he doesn't learn. And at the end of the year, yani he had a big indication that he's going to fail. This is a teacher who has understood this student for less than a year, maybe 8-9 months. So what about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that knows the ins and outs of us? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that knows the decisions that we're going to take. So we still have our free will. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even though we have free will, Allah already knows what decisions we take. And so on the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is right to ask, why did you do such and such? Because Allah knew it, but the fact that Allah knows it doesn't mean that Allah hasn't given us free choice. And we know that Allah has given us free choice. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the Quran to Lawh al-Mahfuz on Laylatul Qadr. And from there, it came down according to the events that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did. And so the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was told, وَنَزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِلَ إِلَيْهِمْ And we reveal the Quran to you so that you may explain it to the people. So one thing is for definite, the Prophet ﷺ explained this Quran to the Sahaba, to the companions. The Prophet ﷺ did not die except that this Quran was understood by the companions. And because that was his mission. And his mission was completed. As Allah says, Al-Yawma akmaltu lakum dinakum. Today I've completed your religion. After that verse, no halal or haram was descended, came down, except for verses that tell people to fear Allah and the day of judgment. Like after that verse, no halal or haram came down. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam revealed the Quran, explained the Quran as Allah wanted it. Does that mean that every single verse the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam stood by and said, Alif Lam Mim means A B C D. ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه means A, B, C, D. The Prophet ﷺ did not explain every single verse. There are certain verses that the companions would ask and they would say, O Messenger of Allah, what does this mean? Like for example, when Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he asks, al-dhulm, oppression. الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَلَمْ يَلْبِسُوا إِيمَانَهُمْ بِظُلْمٍ. Allah says, those that have believed and have not clothed it or have not يعني intermingled their belief with ظلم, أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمُ الْأَمْنِ, they will have safety on the Day of Judgment. Meaning one that has oppression and ظلم will have no safety on the Day of Judgment. So Abdullah ibn Mas'ud will ask, O Messenger of Allah, does that mean that anyone that has commits a certain part of ظلم that they will be in the hellfire? So then the Prophet ﷺ says, no, this verse means that al-ظلم means shirk. It means to worship other than Allah. Do you not know of the other verse where Allah says, إِنَّ الشِّرْكَ لَظُلْمٌ عَظِيمٌ. Indeed, shirk and polytheism is a great oppression. So there are certain verses that the Prophet ﷺ would explain. Like in the majority of the verses, the Prophet, they were straightforward, and if there were ambiguity in it, then the Prophet ﷺ would explain it. So the Quran, the Prophet ﷺ explained it. In another example, Aisha radiallahu anha, when the Prophet ﷺ says on the Day of Judgment, مَنْ حُوسِبَ عُذِّبْ, whoever is taken to account on the Day of Judgment will be punished. Meaning whoever is taken to account on the Day of Judgment, whoever is asked questions on the Day of Judgment, oh, why did you do so and so and so, will be punished. Aisha radiallahu anha, she was a young girl, look at how clever she was. Look at how quickly she picked it up and she says, oh Messenger of Allah, what about the verse where Allah says, فَسَوْفَ يُحَاسَبُ حِسَابًا يَسِيرًا, where Allah says, soon we will account them with an easy account. Their accountability would be easy. How do we, you are just telling us, O Messenger of Allah, that anyone that is taken to account will be punished. And here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَسَوْفَ يُحَاسَبُ حِسَابًا يَسِيرًا وَيَنْقَلِبُ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهِ مَسْرُورًا فَأَمَّا مَنْ أُوْتِيَ كِتَابَهُ بِيَمِينِهِ فَسَوْفَ يُحَاسَبُ حِسَابًا يَسِيرًا. Allah says, one that is given his account on his right hand on the Day of Judgment, you accept your account and the angels give you your book on your right, Allah says, فَسَوْفَ يُحَاسَبُ حِسَابًا يَسِيرًا, they will be taken to an easy account. The accountability will be easy. So Aisha, she quickly understood. She said to the Prophet ﷺ, O Messenger of Allah, how can we put this two together? This verse and your statement just now. So the Prophet ﷺ, he says, that is not what it means, Aisha. Like what it means is, on the Day of Judgment, إِنَّمَا هُوَ الْعَرْضُ, that is only the presentation of your accounts. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would present our accounts. That is an easy account. Allah would say, oh Ahmed, on such and such day, you did this. And you say, yes, oh Allah, I did. Okay, next. Oh Ahmed, on such and such day, you did this. Okay, next. Yani you're just being presented by your accounts, but you're forgiven. So Allah forgives you. Lakin, the person that will be punished on the Day of Judgment is the person where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O Ahmed, you did not pray or you committed such a sin on that day. Why did you do it? And then you have to answer for that. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says then, did you not know it was haram? Yes, O Allah, I did. So why did you do it? That is what it means to have a severe accountability. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make our accountability easy. That is يعني, a dua we ask. Oh Allah, make our accountability easy. Meaning, oh Allah, we know we've made mistakes, like don't press us on those mistakes. Nothing stopped us. Or the only reason we did it is because of our desires. And we knew it was haram. We knew we weren't supposed to do it. Like we've done it, and it was because of our desires we did it. Oh Allah, forgive us. That is an easy accountability. Like a difficult accountability is that you get pressed on your accountability. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he explained the Quran, and the companions, and we know that we have teachers, right, that teach us the Quran. Likewise, the companions, their teacher was the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the teachers of those that came after them were the companions, and it's a chain going all the way to us. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ, we will preserve this Quran. and we're the one that sent it down, and we will take the responsibility of preserving it. And the preservation of the Quran is not only its recitation with tajweed and correct recitation, like in the understanding is preserved as well. Why? Because the Quran came with its understanding. The Quran, the importance, the objective of the Quran was to reveal a message. And the message that contains it is why the Quran came down. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, Inna anzalnahu Quranan Arabiyan la'allakum ta'qilun. We've sent a Quran down in the Arabic language, la'allakum ta'qilun, so that you may understand it. Afala yatadabbarun al-Quran. Do they not ponder over this Quran? And no one can ponder over something if you don't understand its meaning. You can't comprehend something before comprehension comes understanding, knowing what it means. I'm going to Manchester. That is, okay, I understand what it means. Now I'm comprehending it. He's probably taking the bus or he's taking the car. So the comprehension comes after I understood what it means. So the Quran, its meaning was preserved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The way it was preserved is the Arabic language was preserved. Why? Because if the language wasn't preserved, then the Quran would not be preserved. And if the Arabic language died down, and where the language changed, and the only thing that remained from the language was the dialects, then the Quran would have not been understood. Like in the language was preserved through men that preserve this language, whether it is to write down the qawa'id and the rules of the language and the way the language is studied, all of that was preserved. And all of that is part of the preservation of this Quran. So this Quran is preserved, the understanding of it is preserved as well, until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes back the Quran on the Day of Judgment. So, inshallah, hopefully we'll definitely, we've touched on it today. Like next week we'll delve into it even more. A small introduction as to how is this Quran to be understood. We know that there are so many tafsirs, and there are so many tafsirs around. How do we understand this Quran, and how are we supposed to understand it correctly? And there are so many people that every single person will use this Quran as a proof, and the Quran came as a proof. Will use this Quran as a proof for their actions, whether their actions are heretic, whether their actions are correct or not. And you will see everyone using this Quran as a proof. So where does the difference lie, and how do you understand it? Inshallah, we'll continue with that next week. And then hopefully maybe after Ramadan, inshallah, we'll continue with that as well. We'll stop there for now. There are many questions. I'm only going to answer two of these questions, inshallah, because of time. So someone is asking, if you're traveling, should you fast or not? And the traveling depends on what you see as a travel. We know that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would say, لَيْسَ مِنَ الْبِرِّ الصِّيَامُ فِي السَّفَرِ. It is not from righteousness to fast whilst traveling. Like it is permitted for one to fast if they're traveling or not. Like in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave a rukhsah, he gave an option for someone that is traveling, whether they should fast or not. They have the choice whether to fast or not. So, the travel needs to be, what does travel mean? Does it mean if I take my car to the outskirts of London and I come back the evening, is that considered a travel? No, a travel is what we consider a travel. Some people consider traveling, some people like the MPs, for example, they would travel to Scotland and back in the afternoon, a quick travel, is that considered traveling? That probably is not a travel. They probably refer to it as a trip. If it's a trip, then you're not allowed to break your fast. If it's a travel, then you are allowed to break your fast. So it depends what you see as a travel. What we normally see as a travel is one that packs their bags and leaves and maybe comes back after 3-4 weeks. Doesn't matter whether he goes to back home or he goes to faraway land, or he goes to Scotland or Wales. Yani, Wales could be considered a travel, but it could also be considered a trip. So that is where the distinction is. is it considered a travel? So if you're traveling, then you can break your fast. If you're not, and it's just a trip, a day trip or whatever, then you cannot break your fast. So inshallah, we'll stop there. جزاكم الله خيرا صلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى اله وصحبه وسلم بارك الله حياكم